Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to my Friday message. Today, I'll be talking to a special guest of the Duke Global Health Institute. Obviously, work on COVID-19 pandemic fits well within the core mission of the Institute. And Dr. Wendy Perdomo-Mara, Associate Director for Research, will be sharing with us some of the important work they're doing. But before we have that discussion, I'll share some good news. First, in terms of campus COVID surveillance and symptomatic monitoring data, it continues to show very low rates with a total of 6 positives among our faculty, staff, students in the week of September 5th to 11th. And our hospitalizations in the Duke health system are at the lowest point in months. At the state level, there seems to be a leveling off of positivity. So this is all good news. But I want to encourage you to keep up the good work and please don't stop doing what you are all doing to keep each other safe. And besides masking and distancing, I really want to discourage people getting together in groups greater than 10, particularly over food. When we do see a breakthrough, particularly in our community, that's usually the setting in which we see transmission. So some other good news, we heard from the Nanolin H. Duke Fund that we've been awarded $7.1 million over 5 years as continued support for our Strong Start program. This could not come at a more important time. These awards are presented to our outstanding early career physician scientists. And I wanna remind you that our 2020 Strong Start Award recipients, which we announced in May, are Michael Deal in the Department of Pediatrics, Michael Litsky in the Department of Surgery, Joshua Thaden in the Department of Medicine, and Andrea Yu in the Department of Medicine. We are so grateful to the Nanolin H. Duke Fund for this generous grant. And again, it couldn't come at a more important moment for us. I also want to remind everybody to participate in the School of Medicine Research Week, which this year is October 5th to 8th. Of course, it'll be virtual, but the programming this year is so exciting. We have 6 outstanding faculty members. And the Lefkowitz Lecture is going to be given by Helen Hobbs from the University of Texas Southwestern. Her work on the genetics of lipid metabolism led to the understanding of the role of PCSK9 variants in metabolism and the development of new class of drugs. Our clinical research keynote is from Lily Peng from Google Brain. So as you can see, this is going to be an exciting program. There'll be a poster session featuring work from our students, residents, fellows, and postdocs. You can watch for information with the Zoom link in your email or visit our website. Now, welcome to Wendy. Hey, Wendy, how are you doing?
Hey, Mary, doing well. How are you?
First of all, I should disclose to everybody that you're in Eldoret, Kenya, correct?
Yep, we traveled back here last weekend.
So I want to talk a little bit about some of the work in the Global Health Institute, realizing we can't talk about everything. But let's start with vaccines, because that certainly has been on everybody's mind lately. And tell us a little bit about the work that members of the Institute are doing, particularly around the allocation of vaccines worldwide.
Sure, thanks. Thanks for inviting me to talk about the work at the Institute. So, as you're well aware, we have some really world-class researchers at Duke working on the biomedical challenge of developing an effective vaccine. But just having an effective vaccine is really not enough. You have to be able to get it to the people. And we think in the case of COVID, we have to try to get it to almost everybody, right? So DJHI granted a pilot grant to the Center for Policy Impact and Global Health to help them look at vaccine delivery at 2 different levels. So the goal of this project is to identify the most effective strategies to ensure that global allocation of a COVID-19 vaccine achieves maximum public health impact and equity. So at the first level, they're looking at the international landscape. And we know that right now, wealthy countries are making bilateral deals with vaccine manufacturers to buy up, basically to buy futures of vaccines, right? To buy up vaccines. And poorer countries are getting left out of this. So Gavi and WHO established a program called COVAX, which is a global vaccine fund. And they're trying to ensure equitable access to an effective COVID vaccine for all countries. So the funding that we provided helped link researchers at Center for Policy Impact and Global Health with colleagues at the Fuqua School to try to use game theory to understand how to incentivize wealthy countries to invest in COVAX, to join the COVAX facility. and to prevent high-income countries from sort of monopolizing effective vaccines. So that's a really exciting project because that team is already feeding ideas and strategies into the COVAX facility through collaborators at Gavi in real time and trying to influence how that program gets implemented now. So it's a very vibrant interface between sort of research and policy that's happening at on this important topic. And then they're also thinking about the national level. So helping countries take stock of the investments that would be needed to roll out a vaccine when it's ready. So you don't want to wait to start making those investments until after the vaccine is ready, because it takes time to prepare for something as huge as a mass vaccination. So they are working on helping low and middle income countries identify key investments that they need to make in their health system to be able to deploy a vaccine on a large scale very quickly. And I think what's exciting about that project is they have such a diverse and interdisciplinary team that includes, physicians and infectious disease epidemiologists and policymakers and economists and engineers and folks from all different countries really coming together to put solutions on the table that they may not have been able to arrive at with sort of a one-dimensional or a one sort of discipline approach to this problem. And I also think that what's really important about the national level work that they're doing is when you're thinking about mass vaccination, you necessarily have to think about equity, right? You have to think about how do we reach everybody? Yep. And so if you're working on making investments that help you achieve mass vaccination and equity and sort of access to this vaccine, then hopefully you are making investments that down the road will render your whole health system more equitable and more resilient than before. So hopefully these investments are not limited to COVID, that they're really going to be sort of durable and
well, I think we are all hoping that the lessons learned, some of them very painful lessons, will be ones mm-hmm. that will inform us. But I continue to be so impressed with the impact of our faculty's work, both nationally as well as internationally. And it's so important.
Absolutely.
The other big area on all of our minds is mental health. We are now 7+ months into this very altered reality. And we see the strain and stress. We see it certainly locally, but I'm sure globally it is as well. So talk a little bit about how global health faculty are using lessons from the past to really inform how we navigate this challenge.
Yeah, this is also, I think, another really exciting area that the Institute is growing into. So researchers at the Global Health Institute, we have a very strong global mental health team. And we, in particular, Eve Puffer and her colleague, David Ayuku here at Moore University, have been working on mental health interventions for families that have very limited access to mental health resources. So interventions that can be delivered by lay people and have very innovative ways of improving communication across the family structure and helping families become more resilient and cope with stress. And so Eve is Even and Professor Ayuku are working on collaborating with Regine Prochaud-Bell, who's also at the Institute, and adapting those strategies for families in Durham. So families are experiencing really unprecedented stress right now, and they're in need of these mental health interventions and family therapy strategies, but access is quite limited because of resources, but also just not being able to access sort of community resources or coming together with in group therapy and things like that. So in this time of limited access to mental health resources, but a growing mental health problem, can we adapt some of these innovative strategies that have worked in other resource constrained settings to our local context? So we're excited about this opportunity for, this bilateral learning
And that was one of the core conceptual constructs of the Institute. It wasn't just about a unidirectional flow of solutions and information, but bidirectional sharing of solutions. So that's exciting to see that in action.
Yeah.
I want to end by asking you your experience in Eldoret. So how locally and in Kenya are they managing the challenges with COVID?
Yeah, that's been a really interesting contrast to make. So our family traveled back to Durham in March, the end of March, on sort of the last international flights going out of Kenya. And so we got to see sort of the early stages of pandemic response in Kenya, and also experience pandemic response and all of its ups and downs in the US over the last 6 months. And I think that, you know, the Kenyan government acted early and decisively. So they were shutting down international travel before there were 50 cases in the country. And all of those cases were travelers or contacts of travelers. And, you know, they shut down domestic travel for inter-county travel. So within the country, travel from one county to another was restricted. They closed schools, they closed bars and restaurants. They, you know, they had like, they really implemented very dramatic measures very early on. And I think that helped limit the spread of the virus at the community level quite a bit, because the epidemic in Kenya has been much less severe than many places in the US, for example, or in Europe. But one thing that I think is really important to highlight is many of us were focused on the lack of ICUs and the lack of ventilators in Kenya and what this pandemic could do to the healthcare system. And I think what we missed was the strength of their public health system. So in Kenya, we have networks of community health workers. There's a community health worker in every village. Every community health worker is assigned to certain houses, and those families know their community health worker, and the community health worker knows those families. And those community health workers are organized into groups that are supervised by a public health officer who's an employee of the government. And these community health workers have been in place for decades, and they do contact tracing for and case detection for HIV, for tuberculosis, for polio, for measles, for guinea worm. And so with sort of a single phone call, you can activate this entire network all the way down to the ground, every household, of people who already know how to do contact tracing. So in Kenya, our contact tracing completion rate for 14 days, like 95%, right?
Wow.
Because we can find those people because this public health network is already in place. So I think that that's a really key distinction to make.
In fact, as you recall, I got to see that in action when I visited you in Eldoret, and it's really remarkable how that works. And again, a great example of the bidirectional learning that needs to happen. Wendy, Absolutely. It's so great to see you. Thank you so much for sharing just some of the stories of what Global Health Institute faculty are doing. We'll get you back to tell us more. And I want to thank them all for all their work, and thank all our faculty, and everybody have a safe and restful weekend. Take care.
Thanks for inviting me, Mary. Bye.
Bye.